bumper.
Got a bird's eye view, and it certainly doesn't look good from up here.
The tank is full. The engine's humming. Those wide open roads are beckoning. So sit back and get ready for Motoring 89. Brought to you by Quaker State. The big Q stands for quality. Always has, always will. This week on Motoring 89.
Standard or Euro, luminous coupes and sedans are soon to become one of Canada's most popular vehicles. Sleek, stylish, state-of-the-art, and built right here.
Swerving very smoothly back and forth, just as though, oh my goodness, there's a cat. Oh, we must avoid the cat.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to Motoring 89. Well, as the sign says, we're at the Autolin Exotic Car Dealership in Oakville, Ontario. This place is home to such names as Lamborghini, Ferrari, Alfa Romeo, Porsche, and so on. But you know, I'm not a happy man this week. See, the plan was for me to take a few of these cars out on the highway. But as you can see, it's raining today, and you don't take machines like these out on a highway on a day like today. But we are going inside the showroom, and you will get a glimpse of some of these cars that are worth over $200,000. But first, we're going to join Sandra Neal in a showroom. But this showroom happens to be one of the biggest in North America. It's called the Auto Show.
For the first few months of every new year, convention centers like this one in North America are booked solid with automotive shows for the consumer. There are state-of-the-art cars on display to whet your appetite, and there are even fashion shows and dance routines to entertain you. But behind all the fanfare are millions of dollars worth of calculated marketing. Automotive shows are big business.
This is one of the primary marketing media that the manufacturers use. And they have made big commitments in terms of investment in these shows to show their products and to introduce their products. So yes, it is big business, and it's very serious business.
Do you have any problems when Ford and Chrysler call in, make sure that they're not side by side?
Actually, no, because all of the exhibits are allocated by draw. So there is never ever a question as to whether their location is good or bad. It's done by lottery, and that's how they receive their locations.
Auto shows are an outstanding opportunity for companies like General Motors to work with their dealer body in a major metropolitan area to have the opportunity to showcase all of our new products for the coming model year. And the buying public can not only look at General Motors, but they can look at everyone who's, and it just gives a lot of excitement to the business.
Auto shows are now center stage for the unveiling of prototype vehicles and world premieres. Car enthusiasts who visited Toronto's auto show this year were the first to witness the unveiling of Nissan's 300ZX model for 1990.
My name is Craig Hind, and I'm president of the 16th Annual Toronto International Auto Show.
The shows have become a gathering place for automotive journalists and photographers. And manufacturers hope to make the headlines by clinching awards like the Car of the Year.
And the winner is... A drum roll, please. The best car, truck of the year, Ford Taurus SHO.
It really is a testimonial given to us by the public that allows the other half of the public to at least consider our car and put them on our shopping list as they start to think about what kind of cars they buy. It's a very important award to us, and one that that we really count on each year.
And while awards like these bring credibility to the shows and draw attention from the media, you'll still find the unusual and the entertaining.
Powered by a special 1.3-liter fuel-injected engine.
Turn it on the other side. Now look in one application how much liquid my chamois is going to absorb under the carpet, okay?
There's only one seat better than this one, and it's right down here, behind the wheel.
Smile.
Great.
Standard or Euro, luminous coupes and sedans are soon to become one of Canada's most popular vehicles. Sleek, stylish, state-of-the-art, and built right here. So,
I know everything I know about the car, I guess. I mean, I'm sure that the dealers and whatnot could help you a lot more than I could, but I can answer general information if somebody were to come and ask me, you know. I'm not an expert by any means, but I know the script.
Though many exhibits provide entertainment, the people who attend auto shows are serious about examining the new models. Most shows can sell you a car right off the platform.
Excuse me, could you tell me how much that RX-7 is?
Okay, this year the RX-7 Turbo is around $37,000.
Are you looking for a car here today?
Not really. You know, we tend to dream a bit when we're here, you know, seeing the different things that are around, but things like this really do something for me. And every year if something new and more innovative comes out, it's always interesting to see it and being the first one there.
Cadillac is just loaded with new features and
in terms of the manufacturer's long-term commitment, they are sometimes up to 2 and 3 years planning for the changes that they are looking at for their exhibits. So it's long-term. As soon as this show is over, we start the next show. That's how long we're planning ahead.
Well, as you can see from these prototypes, the manufacturers are also planning for the year 2000. But whether or not these predictions end up in the driveways of the future, well, we'll have to leave that decision up to the drivers of the future.
Three, go! When Motoring 89 returns, we'll test the T-Bird.
There's a rough road ahead with no end in sight. Quaker State engines don't know when to quit.
Quaker State is the only motor oil with QSX, quality engineered to exceed every single car maker's Canadian requirements for maximum engine protection. So pistons are protected from friction mile after mile. Valves are protected from wear year in, year out. That's why Quaker State engines run strong and run long.
Quaker State engines don't know when to quit.
The big Q stands for quality. Always has, always will.
Test Drive with Graham Fletcher.
This week we're in Kleinburg, Ontario, the home of the Group of Seven. Although you're unlikely to find this 1989 Thunderbird in any of their paintings, it does hold the distinction of being the only three-time winner of Motor Trend's prestigious Car of the Year award. We're going to go right now to the skid pad and find out why it earned those honors.
When you combine a heavy car and soft suspension, you nearly always get understeer or the tendency for the car to plow. The other thing that's evident running down here is that I can beat the power steering, which is not a particularly good thing. However, you shouldn't drive a car like that on the road, and so it won't be a problem to prospective purchasers. Now, I mentioned understeering or the tendency to plow, which means that I'm telling the car to go right, but the weight and the inertia is forcing it straight ahead instead of to the right.
The new Thunderbird features a fully independent suspension system, and an unusual feature is the tow link. Now this tow link fits between the control arm and the subframe and actually steers the rear wheels during high side loading or over large bumps. What it does is provide some tow in on the loaded wheel, so you actually prevent trailing throttle oversteer. Now in English that means that it makes the car a lot easier to handle when you push it.
Now we're at 80 kilometers an hour. I'm going to hit the brakes and see what happens. That's just superb. You can feel the brakes just pumping and bringing you to a stop as quick as you're going to be. Just superb. That's the way brakes should work. Despite my criticisms of the suspension on the skid pan, when you actually get out on the road, it's a very comfortable car to ride in. A lot of glass gives you a very airy, spacious feeling.
While the 89 T-Bird is actually 3 inches shorter than its predecessor, Ford have actually managed to increase the wheelbase by 9 inches. This not only helps in the handling, but it certainly aided the comfort.
The dash on the LX is digital, which I guess according to your taste, you either like or you don't. I'm not a fan of digital dashes, but as they go, this is a clean, clear layout.
Our test car featured a 3.8-litre V6 with a 4-speed automatic transmission. However, if you choose, there is a supercharged version dubbed the SC. And what it does is boosts the horsepower from 140 to 210. This, my friends, is not for the faint of heart. The T-Berg we tested featured automatic headlights, and as you can see, the sensor to turn them on and off is actually hidden up behind the interior mirror. A side benefit of this suspension setup is a smaller intrusion into the car, which actually results in a larger trunk with a flatter floor.
Now we're back in Kleinberg after the road test, I've learnt two things. Firstly, it's certainly a better car on the road than it is on the skid pan, and secondly, it's a very quiet car on the highway. However, I'm not letting it off that easy. I do have a pet peeve, and the pet peeve is the quality of the fit and finish. It disappointed me on a $26,000 car. This piece here looks like it was an afterthought. There's far too much rubber around the weather stripping at the back, and the horn pad was loose. Now, I'm hoping this is just on this car and not on the ones that they're going to be putting out through the showrooms. Anyway, let's go to the scoreboard now and see how I rated the rest of this terrific coupe.
The anti-lock brakes are superb and are a model example of how brakes should work. Minus the supercharger, the Thunderbird is definitely leisurely to the 100 kilometer an hour mark. I wasn't overly impressed. I found the LX suspension too soft to handle well, but it does provide excellent highway comfort. At 68 decibels, this T-Bird is certainly quiet. Although we managed an average of around 24 miles per gallon, if you push the T-Bird, you're going to drop to a very thirsty 20 or so miles per gallon. Despite my criticisms, the 89 Thunderbird is definitely the best large coupe around, and so I awarded an overall mark of 8 out of 10.
I think I found the car of my dreams. I'll show you later on Behind the Wheel.
Next on Motoring 89, Bill sparks interest.
Well, I'm now inside the showroom here at Autoland Exotic Cars, and with me is the sales manager, Dave Marcuzzi. Dave, welcome to Motoring 89.
Thank
the first question I have to ask you is, what's your clientele like? What kind of clientele comes in here and purchases cars that are worth, I believe, over $200,000?
Well, we deal with a lot of entrepreneurs from the Toronto, Oakville, Mississauga, Burlington area, a lot of cell phone owners of companies in the area. What we're authorized to sell is Lamborghini, Lotus, Alfa Romeo. Also, we carry anything from Ferraris, Ferrari Testarossa, Porsche, Jaguar, Benz.
Dave, do you take credit cards?
Yes, we do. We call them in and get them authorized, and we'll be glad to take them.
Okay, maybe I'll be back.
Okay, Brad.
Thanks, Dave.
Thank you.
All right, now we're going to head into one of the most important rooms just back here at the dealership, and that, of course, is the garage. We're going to look under the hood of a $250,000 Lamborghini, and we're going to meet the men who keep these cars in running order, the mechanics. But first, we're going to visit with our chief mechanic on Motoring 89, Bill Gardner, and this week, Bill wants to talk about spark plugs.
Fortunately, replacement of the spark plugs is still a fairly easy task on most of today's cars. You will need a few tools. An average socket set contains a spark plug socket, and you may need a gapping tool to gap the new plugs and a boot removal tool in order to pull some of those spark plug boots off. The first thing you should do is identify the spark plug wires so that you can reinstall them in the same firing order when you're finished. The next step is to use the boot removal tool to help you remove the spark plug boots. Set them aside and crack the spark plug loose a turn or two. This is going to disturb the dirt and the grit that's laying in there, and we're going to blow it out so it doesn't drop in the cylinder. If your car has a V8 engine where the spark plugs are installed horizontally, you may be able to bypass this next step. But many cars today, like this one, have the spark plugs installed almost vertically. In that case, it's important to use compressed air and our safety glasses to blow out the grit and sand that accumulates in those plug holes. We don't want it to fall inside the engine. Once you've cleaned the dirt out of the plug holes, you can remove the spark plugs and lay them aside in the sequence that they came out of the engine, because the used spark plugs quite often tell a story about the condition of that engine. Now we're going to inspect the spark plugs to determine the gap and the condition of the spark plug. We're looking for anything like fouling or cracking or wear of the spark plug tip. Now these used spark plugs are still in good shape. Nice square clean gap to them, no fouling, no cracks. They're in good shape. They can be reinstalled. We're just going to check the gap. If the gap's okay, we can reinstall it. This one's a little bit wide, so we'll tighten it up. In order to determine the correct spark plug for your engine and the appropriate gap for your new spark plugs, you can either consult the tune-up decal located somewhere under the hood or consult the owner's manual. We've reinstalled these spark plugs. It's a good idea to mention, put a drop of oil on the spark plug threads before you reinstall them. It'll make life a lot easier the next time. It's also a good idea to have a look at these boots at this time. Make sure that they're not charred or burnt inside or corroded. The boots should still be supple and not contaminated with oil or grease. If they're in good shape, they can be reinstalled. Now the job's complete. Until next week, I'm Bill Gardner for Motoring 89.
And now, Behind the Wheel with Charlie Goodman.
Last week, we decided that this car checked out okay, and it was time to take it for a test drive.
There are three dynamic tests to be performed during the test drive of a vehicle. They are braking, swerving, and cornering manners. We're going to do braking first by accelerating to 50 kilometers an hour. Having achieved 50, we will then brake on the threshold just short of lockup and take our hands off the wheel to make certain that the vehicle tracks nice and true. And where we go, brakes on and hands off, nice and true to a complete stop. Very nice, quiet car. For the swerving test, we have purposely selected a very quiet street. Again, we will be accelerating to 50 kilometers an hour and then swerving, just as though you were trying to avoid a crisis. 49, 50, and away we go. Swerving very smoothly, back and forth, just as though, oh my goodness, there's a cat. Oh, we must avoid the cat. Again, as you can see, I'm not having to overreact to any motions of the suspension of the car. Again, a car that accepts all of this activity with grace and poise. Our third test is cornering manners. The key to this thing is to find a nice speed that's not too fast where the vehicle is just starting to get a little bit unsettled. We don't want you tearing around the neighborhood, making a lot of noise and upsetting the neighbors. Just enough speed that the car is starting to feel the slightest little bit uncomfortable. What we will do then is we will give it a little shot of gas and then lift off abruptly and see if the car can very quietly handle these transitions. So here we are, on our little circle, we'll start to accelerate. We've got 20, 23, there's 30. Starting to feel a little uncomfortable. I've had to come off a little bit there at 30. So at 30, we'll just keep it there and we'll give it some gas. Here we go. And lift off abruptly, very nicely. One more, lift off, pretty good. And we'll try one more. We're still doing 30. It's a very constant up to 30. We got all the way to 40 there and back down again. As you can see from my movements on the steering wheel, I haven't had to make any huge corrections such as this to catch it. The car has been very capable of handling everything that I've thrown at it. Again, I think this car has passed the third test with flying colors.
Still ahead on Motoring 89.
Car and Driver magazine christened it a striking piece of automotive sculpture. It has a 138 horsepower engine, a drag coefficient that embarrasses the Porsche 911, and a multi-link suspension with optional full-time all-wheel drive. Introducing the 1990 Nissan Access, the first sports car for parents.
There's a rough road ahead with no end in sight. Quaker State engines don't know when to quit.
Quaker State is the only motor oil with QSX, quality engineered to exceed every single car maker's Canadian requirements for maximum engine protection. So pistons are protected from friction mile after mile. Valves are protected from wear year in, year out. That's why Quaker State engines run strong and run long.
Quaker State engines don't know when to quit.
The big QU stands for quality. Always has, always will.
I get the feeling, looking around here, that this is not exactly your ordinary garage.
No, no, not at all. This is a really special car. And I've been here for now 2 years, and I can honestly say I'm not tired of these cars at all. They're exciting, everyone's different, and we've got the whole spectrum of them here. We've got V12s, 6s, the works. The mechanics are more than mechanics. Just a license is not good enough. You have to be a little bit of a craftsman. You have to have a real and genuine love for these cars.
When I was 9 years old, I was still trying to master the bicycle. Now, these kids may still ride bikes, but once they get to the track, they mean business. This is the Canadian National Go-Kart Championships.
It's also the future of racing in Canada, because underneath those Nomex suits, you might find another Paul Tracy, or Scott Goodyear, or even John Jones. Because after all, this is where they got started.
I have been racing 4 years, and I am in two-stroke, which is a faster kind of motor than a four-stroke. And my class name is Superstock Junior.
So how fast do you go in those cars?
Well, the maximum the two-stroke could reach would be about 100 miles an hour.
100 miles an hour at 12 years old. Don't you get scared out there?
No way.
Well, first time I wiped out, I was scared. But then after a while, I got used to it.
You gotta get a good start. You gotta get a real good start in this thing. Okay, we're sitting right behind the pole guy. He's gonna take off, you go right with him.
While some parents in this country are secretly longing for the second coming of Wayne Gretzky, some are discontent with another Rick Mears in the family.
I started him at 6 years old with the soapbox racing and tried to get him in, and that's a good sport. And while he was soapbox racing at 7, I bought him a go-kart. And at that time, the insurance regulations weren't as strict as they are now. They used to let the kids out on the track, and he'd run around, and every once in a while he'd come in with a bent wheel, and I'd weld it up, and away we'd go again, and he learned how to drive. And then when it would rain out, I'd take him out to Whippy and lower the tire pressures, and he'd go out there, and he'd spin around, and he'd straighten it out, and he'd come off like a drowned rat. But he knew that when he spun around, he could drive the car backwards, and, you know, it gave him confidence.
For Jim and Brad Pearsall, go-kart racing is more than just a family outing. The father and son team has sights set on the big leagues.
I want to race sprint cars.
Why?
It looked fun to drive.
Yeah. When you watch racing on TV, do you have a favorite form of racing other than sprint cars and a favorite driver?
Dale Earnhardt.
A boy out there who has an accident, please let the officials look after him. We do not need 25 people out on the track.
Okay, Chris, get busy. You only got 2 hours. Are you putting the camera on the cart, or?
How quick do these cars go?
The four cycle guys will be doing down the straightaway here, they'll be doing maybe 60. Where you get the international and the direct drive classes, they'll be doing 90, closer to 100.
No one came close to hitting those speeds, at least the weekend I was there. But who knows? This could just be the beginning of something big.
Next week on Motoring 89.
The ultimate transportation for the rich and famous. I mean, I think limousines were created for people to do naughty things behind tinted windows. I love limousines because you can drink a lot of champagne. My dream limousine would be a little faucet inside on the back seat, champagne on tap.
You know something? Dreams do come true. You're looking at a 1989 Lamborghini Countach, the 25th anniversary edition. Well, that's it for this week. Next week, we're going to be in Phoenix, Arizona for the opening of the kart season, so we'll see you then. Boy, am I having fun.
If you have any questions or suggestions, drop us a line at Motoring89. 379 Danforth Avenue, Toronto, Ontario. M4K 1P1. Motoring 89 is brought to you by Quaker State. The big Q stands for quality. Always has, always will.